There's a lot of debate about pride these days. Should we allow cops? Should we allow all forms of expression, or just the ones that are palatable to conservative audiences? When people argue that cops should be allowed, or that certain subcultures should not be, they're usually really vague about it. They often appeal to a vague sense of quote-unquote morality. Here's former San Francisco City Supervisor Dan White, back in the 1970s, voicing concerns that still sound very familiar today.
What did you see that you thought was obscene?
Well, I see naked men walking around, naked women walking around, which doesn't bother me as far as my personal standards of nudity or what, but it's not proper. Many people do not approve of outward displays of sexuality, be it heterosexuality or homosexuality. And this is a point I stand firm on, and I think the gay community themselves would find hard to refute the statements I'm making now. And this is a problem. We wouldn't allow it for any other parade in San Francisco, and it should not be allowed for the gay parade.
What's left out of these arguments are queer voices, the history of pride, and definitely the history of the LGBTQIA plus experience in America. San Francisco Mayor London Breed recently said that she will not be attending SF Pride this year because the Pride Board ruled that cops will not be allowed to march in uniform. She claimed that she was making the very hard decision to support those members of the LGBTQ community who serve in uniform in our police department and sheriff's department who have been told that they cannot march in uniform. While I was editing this video, on June 2nd, San Francisco Police Department's LGBTQ liaison officer, Catherine Winters, who happens to be a trans police officer, met with Pride organizers and clarified that cops weren't necessarily upset about not being allowed to wear their uniforms in the parade. They were upset that they couldn't carry their guns. As someone who grew up in the San Francisco Bay Area myself, Mayor Breed's statement about siding with the cops in refusing to march unless they could wear their uniforms slash carry their firearms seemed kind of odd to me. Why? Well, because London Breed was also born and raised in San Francisco since the mid-70s, so she should be well aware of this particular story from SF history, that in 1978, an ex-cop named Dan White entered City Hall through a window that he knew was left unlocked. He went to the mayor's office and shot Mayor George Moscone in the shoulder and chest, and then twice in the head, execution style, with his police-issued revolver. Dan White then found Harvey Milk, the first openly gay city commissioner in the United States, the first openly gay man to win a non-incumbent election in the United States, and the first openly gay man to be elected to public office in California. Dan White assassinated Harvey Milk, shooting him 5 times. Dan White was put on trial, and the SF police vocally and often violently supported his release. They wore shirts that said, "Free Dan White," immediately after the murder. The court and jury, which gay and ethnic minorities were not allowed to be on because of course they weren't, acquitted Dan White of first-degree murder, often showing sympathy for the killer, as if he hadn't just walked into City Hall on an assassination mission. He was convicted of mere manslaughter. Let me just state this clearly. Every Pride march in San Francisco since 1978 has been held under the shadow of the assassination of a pioneering gay activist and the progressive mayor. Assassination by a former police officer with his police-issued revolver. And then that cop was acquitted of first-degree murder by an anti-LGBTQIA plus court and jury. And Mayor London Breed has the audacity to pretend she doesn't know the history of her own city and political office. Or maybe she's well aware that there are current members of the SFPD who would do the same to her if she steps out of line. While politicians like London Breed actively try to repress history, there are other people, like Tucker Carlson, who actively embrace that violent history. In April 2021, it was revealed that in Tucker Carlson's 1991 college yearbook, he was listed as a member of the Dan White Society. Carlson would have been a boy when Harvey Milk and Mayor Moscone were assassinated, but apparently he didn't forget about it, and even celebrated the murders into adulthood, and assumedly to this day. I just want to say that again. Tucker Carlson was part of a society that worshipped an ex-cop who murdered a pioneering gay activist and his ally. But all this history can feel very abstract. So after the Tucker Carlson story broke, I wanted to write about what it felt like to grow up in the wake of the Harvey Milk assassination. The following is based on a Twitter thread that I wrote trying to come to terms with history and where we're at today and why pride fucking matters. It took me a few days to process the fact that Tucker Carlson put Dan White Society in his yearbook. I want to share the impact that right-wing terrorist Dan White had on my own life as a queer kid growing up in the Bay Area in the aftermath of White assassinating Harvey Milk. I hadn't been born yet when right-wing terrorist Dan White went to San Francisco City Hall to shoot Mayor Moscone and Harvey Milk. He shot both men multiple times, finishing them off with execution-style shots to the head. I was born a few years later. However, in the 1970s, my dad was a businessman who knew the mayor and frequently went to City Hall. It's very possible he even knew Dan White. When my dad heard the news of the assassinations, he would have thought, I could have been there. My dad was also very weird. People liked him, but he didn't have any real friends in the city, despite living there all his life. I now realize that many of the ways that my dad was considered weird are traits that I exhibit and recognize as part of my own non-binary gender expression. My dad tried so hard to look conservative, always wearing suits with a very clean haircut. Looking at a picture of him, you would have no idea that he was different. But meeting him, you'd know within minutes because of the way he carried himself and his sense of humor. I owe so much of my own sense of humor to him, which really tears me up when I think about it, because to me, being funny means being vulnerable and emotionally honest, but for him, it was like he was hiding something, playing something off as a joke. I can't know anything for sure about my dad's gender or sexuality because he was a tragically repressed conservative, but I know other people questioned his sexuality. He married somewhat late, carried himself oddly, and there are various other suspicious anecdotes that I won't share. So not only would my dad have reacted to the assassination with, I could have been there at City Hall, he very likely would have thought, if Dan White saw me, he would have read me as gay and executed me too. The news of Harvey Milk's assassination broke the same month that my parents got home from their honeymoon. Their marriage began under the shadow of an ex-cop assassinating a pioneering openly gay politician. As I mentioned, my dad was also deeply conservative. He was a Nixon apologist. He loved that people would always say he looked like George W. Bush. And by the time he passed away a few years ago, he'd lost touch with reality to the point that he thought Donald Trump was his soulmate. Yet despite that, he did show compassion for queer people, at least gay and lesbian people, when I was a kid. The one time he ever mentioned his cousin who happened to be gay, my dad spoke of him fondly. Although my dad didn't mention until years later that his cousin passed away from AIDS in the 1980s. He didn't use homophobic slurs or demean people for being gay. His homophobia took on a different form. He was deeply aware that no matter what he did, no matter how conservative he looked and dressed, if people read him as queer, a right-wing assassin might walk into his place of work and shoot him in the head simply for existing. He was deeply aware that if one of his children turned out to be queer, no matter how respectable we were, a right-wing assassin might walk into our place of work and shoot us in the head simply for existing. To him, being queer was a death sentence. So before I was even born, my dad decided that I was not gay for my own good. Before I had a chance to develop my own identity, he blocked off an entire lifetime of possibilities as forbidden. One reason it took me so long to put together my thoughts about the Dan White Society thing is that my dad's method of trying to make me straight wasn't to bully me into it, not at first anyways. His method was to ignore things, to conceal things, to deny things. I remember him telling me about Mayor Moscone's murder when we went to Moscone Center for a convention. He told me about how Dan White climbed into City Hall through a window to avoid the metal detector. He knew the details intimately, but he didn't mention Harvey Milk. I grew up in the suburbs, and I remember being terrified of going to the city when I was a kid because of the way my dad would talk about murder. Like the story about some old businessman he knew who was mugged for a mere 20 bucks. The mugger hit him over the head, and the old guy died from internal bleeding. But my dad never talked about Harvey Milk. Another weird thing about my dad, I never heard him say a curse word in my entire life. He said when he was a kid, his mom literally washed his mouth out with soap, basically describing a torture scene, so he never cursed again. His whole life was spent avoiding saying things. Instead of cursing, he'd say fiddlesticks, goofy things like that. A grown man furiously shouting fiddlesticks and gosh darn it. His preferred method of homophobia was erasure, to the point that he tried to erase his and my own individuality. things like Harvey Milk's assassination or anything about LGBTQIA plus people, whether positive or negative, didn't really exist in our household. It was like a giant black hole sucked up any hint of those things, despite the fact that San Francisco was and is one of the most visibly queer places on Earth. When I was young, he'd constantly point out women on the street and comment on their attractiveness as if to try to convince me and my brothers to be straight. Even when we were kids, it annoyed the hell out of us because it felt so forced. As I got older, his homophobia got less subtle, partially because I got quote-unquote weirder, but also because the assassination of Harvey Milk was a prelude to the mass murder that Ronald Reagan would carry out on gay men via the AIDS epidemic. So not only could being gay get you shot in the head by a right-wing assassin, it could also get you killed slowly by a right-wing president, too. As I mentioned earlier, my dad's cousin died of AIDS in the 1980s. But I didn't hear about that until after we saw Dallas Buyers Club in 2013 and he finally told me that story. And my mom finally told me about her gay cousin who died of AIDS, who she had never mentioned before. The first 20 years of my life were spent in absolute misery, and I didn't even know why. I inherited my dad's weirdness, which was clear, but I also inherited his repression, his self-hatred, his denial, none of which I even realized until decades later. I always knew I was different. When I was in high school and all the other kids in my class were making plans for college, I couldn't imagine my life past 18. I couldn't explain why, but it was like, once school was done, I imagined I would just disappear. I knew that a conventional way of life didn't make sense for me, but I couldn't understand why. I had a complicated relationship with my dad. I loved him, but he drove me fucking nuts. I loved who he really was, his weirdness, his sense of humor, and his kindness. But there was this other part of him, this thing that felt like a parasite, a sickness, a disease, his conservative ideology. No matter how much conservatives abused or threatened him, he obeyed the party line, even after getting his mouth washed out with soap, or the side eyes he'd get from business associates, or the literal right-wing assassin who murdered people that he knew. My dad did everything in the world to try to appease the conservatives around him. He destroyed his relationship with me, his own child, for them. And what would they give him in return? A bullet to the head if given the chance, topped off with a smirk and a giggle from Tucker Carlson. In the 80s and 90s, my dad got really involved with the San Francisco Police Department as much as he could. I remember one time he took me to some kind of picnic event that was put on by the Police Officers Association. Occasionally, he'd go to the police firing range. Now, I realize he did all those things simply to make himself more visible to cops, so they wouldn't pull a Dan White on him. And if you think I'm painting cops in an unfairly cruel light here, just listen to this description of how the police responded during the White Night riots in May of 1979, as the gay community was outraged by Dan White's lenient sentence. From Wikipedia. The second stage of the violence was a police raid slash riot hours later in the predominantly gay Castro neighborhood, which vandalized the Elephant Walk bar and injured many of its occupants. After order was restored at City Hall, SFPD cars carrying dozens of officers headed into the Castro district. Officers entered a gay bar called the Elephant Walk despite their orders not to do so. They shouted dirty cocksuckers and sick fats, shattered the large plate glass windows of the bar, and attacked patrons. After 15 minutes, police withdrew from the bar and joined other officers who were indiscriminately attacking gays on the street. The incident lasted nearly 2 hours. When Police Chief Charles Gain heard about the unauthorized Elephant Walk raid, he immediately went to the location and ordered his men to leave. Later that night, freelance reporter Michael Weiss saw a group of police officers celebrating at a downtown bar. "We were at City Hall the day the killings happened, and we were smiling then," one officer explained. "We were there tonight, and we're still smiling." Right-wing death squads, RWDS, is a conservative meme. They think it's funny. They think assassination is funny. They think destroying families is funny. They think homophobia, queerphobia, and bigotry are funny. I am the product of a conservative household, terrorized by right-wing extremism. My dad did everything right by the conservative playbook, and it nearly destroyed our family. Around the time I was in high school and college, there was a period of 6 or 8 years where my dad and I basically didn't speak to each other, didn't look at each other. I felt repulsed when my parents would hug me. I felt repulsed by all physical human contact. For years, I stopped saying I love you back to my parents when they'd say it to me. My dad didn't seem to care, but I know it hurt my mom. That physical repulsion contributed to me hating my own body, compounded by the fact that I'd always had some degree of body dysmorphia. I never really felt at home in my own body. Around that same time, in high school, I started experiencing chronic pain that distanced me from my own body even more. Migraines and other health issues led to so much pain, I just wanted to escape my own body. As I mentioned earlier, I was always weird. I carried myself awkwardly and clumsily. Another symptom of that awkwardness was that I had trouble speaking. For the first 30 years or so of my life, I had trouble clearly saying a single sentence from start to finish, especially when I was around strangers. I couldn't articulate my thoughts. I couldn't answer simple questions. Almost every spoken interaction felt like an interrogation. This was coupled with being neurodivergent. Words didn't make sense. I couldn't read books. I couldn't do my homework. I couldn't function in class. Teachers thought I was just misbehaving no matter how hard I tried to focus and do well. I was too weird, couldn't follow trends, couldn't interact with other kids in a way that they thought was normal. But of course, I knew that I was a straight boy because that's what I'd been told all my life. So I pursued girls. But I had zero ability to develop any kind of meaningful romantic relationship with girls, thanks to the fact that I hated my own body and I couldn't engage in even the most basic conversation. The first few times I did go out with girls, I got so nauseous I had to excuse myself to go throw up. There was something deeply wrong and I had no idea what. My body could feel the repression and self-hatred, but I didn't have the words to articulate it. I couldn't understand. I made zero friends in college. I would just go to the library, check out a stack of books, and read in my bedroom. At that point, I'd at least trained myself to focus enough to read about topics I was interested in. I also watched every movie I could. Movies were a window into human interaction that was safe because I could just be a fly on the wall. Even in real life, I was very emotionally intelligent when I was eavesdropping or watching other people interact. But the moment someone looked me in the eyes and asked me a question or otherwise expected something from me in an interaction, I would lock up and panic. My life didn't really start until I moved down to LA in my late 20s. And even then, it took a few years before I really felt like I was living a life. Now I'm nearing 40, and despite all the horrible shit going on in the world, at least I can say I've found myself. I'm in a relationship with an infinitely loving, kind person who gives me the space to find myself. I'm happy for the first time in my life. I hope these thoughts are helpful to someone who is in a similar situation that I was in. I hope people come to better understand how these phobias and bigotries and denials actually function within our society and within our families. Otherwise, kids will stay trapped like I was. Confused and with no legible map out of the dungeon. I'm here, I'm pan, I'm non-binary, I'm proud, and I'm not going anywhere, no matter how badly Tucker Carlson wants an ex-cop to put a bullet in my head. By the way, the reason that my dad's family business went under is because a national corporation came in and crushed it using unfair, illegal, anti-union business practices. So my dad didn't even get the financial reward that conservatives pretend you'll earn if you play ball. Instead, he spent the last few years of his life worshiping the same corporate conservatives who'd ruined his livelihood. Once the family business was gone, he lost the will to live. They didn't kill him with a gun. They killed him with capitalism. And he loved them for it. People's understanding of homophobia, queerphobia, transphobia, NB-phobia is so elementary. As if, as long as somebody doesn't explicitly say the F slur, then it's not actually bigotry. But there are much more subtle forms of those bigotries, which are just as deadly. If society is going to do anything about systemic injustice, white America needs a reckoning. White supremacy starts in white homes, where white children and white women are subjected to the tyranny of white patriarchs, and it spreads from there. This is not to say that white people are bigger victims of white supremacy than anyone else. I'm simply trying to articulate how white people are dehumanized by white supremacy itself. White people are the initial perpetrators of white supremacy, but they are also the first victims in that cycle of abuse and violence. Then they perpetuate that violence to convince themselves that they're not the victims, to convince themselves that they're in control. But they're not in control. They're carrying out the will of an ideology that doesn't care about them. An ideology that would execute them as soon as smile at them. One of the ways that white supremacy infects young white boys, or people who convince themselves that they're boys, is by getting us to tell ourselves that we're tough. We're real men. Real men don't cry or complain. Real men don't do any kind of self-care. As a young non-binary person, when I felt pain, I'd tell myself, "But I'm tough. I can handle it." Even when that pain made me not want to live anymore, even when that pain was so strong, I knew that something was wrong, that something was off, that something didn't add up. Conservatives have created a whole economy of toughness. The gun industry is one giant scam to get people to pay thousands of dollars to prove that they're tough, while simultaneously turning them into cowering babies and giving them the ability to murder people that white America says it's okay to murder. Well, as an openly non-binary person, I'm tougher now than I've ever been. I used to feel like I was an error, like I was my own worst enemy. But now I love myself. I was fighting against myself because I couldn't see that what I should have been fighting against was the Tucker Carlsons of the world. My dad had a spark within him, a goofy, wonderful, joyous spark. And over the decades, that spark died out as he tried to hide it, to conceal it from the men who would happily murder him if they got a glimpse of it. In closing, Tucker Carlson deserves to burn in the hottest circle of hell imaginable. He has blood on his hands from every hate crime in this country. Pride matters. Conservatives and other bigots try to tell us that pride is a sin. Yes, it can be a sin. Yes, their blasphemous pride in evangelical Christianity and fascism are sinful. But being proud of who you are and expressing yourself is not a sin. Showing up in the face of a country that wants to literally assassinate us is not a sin. It's necessary. Showing unwavering support for all forms of LGBTQIA plus expression is necessary. Showing pride is necessary. The people who used to smile openly at our murders are now trying to use the diversity of our identities as wedges to get us to turn on each other. It's called pride for a reason. It's not called the shame parade. It's about expression. It's about pushing boundaries of acceptance and loving who you are. Self-love should not come with caveats. Acting like a straight cis conservative is not the way to gain equality. Early on, Harvey Milk was influenced by counterculture. He looked like a hippie. But during his political campaign in 1975, he adopted suits and a clean haircut to appeal to mainstream America. They killed him anyway. The homophobes and transphobes and kinkphobes have lost a few battles, but they're not going to stop until they win the war. And to them, to these murder apologists, it is a war. Cops at Pride aren't trying to gain acceptance. They're trying to gain control. That's what being a cop is, controlling other people's bodies and lives and property. And remember, it's not even ban cops from Pride. It's ban cops in uniform. The very uniform that triggers old queens like me who remember our history. They try to kill us with murder. They try to kill us by denying an epidemic. They try to kill us by forcing us to turn on each other. And they haven't stopped trying to kill us. This year, as you celebrate Pride, I hope you celebrate your full self. I hope you celebrate without reservation and without shame. I hope you celebrate every stripe of the LGBTQIA plus rainbow and every marginalized group within it and every intersecting identity within it. Because there is nothing the TERFs, homophobes, transphobes, and gender fascists hate more than when we are truly, unflinchingly, unapologetically ourselves. They know that their society is based on a lie, and that's why they hate it when we show that we have pride. Thanks for watching this video. I hope you're having a wonderful Pride Month. If this video made you want to get involved, consider joining a local mutual aid organization or contributing to an LGBTQIA plus nonprofit to support your community. If you want to support me as a creator, you can follow me on Twitter and or send me a few bucks on Ko-fi. Don't forget to subscribe, like the video, and leave a comment about your own experiences with Pride or with cops. I plan on making more videos on this channel, but they'll probably be a bit lighter in tone. Mostly about queerness in film or other issues I'm interested in. Currently, I'm writing one about the hidden legacy of bisexuality in Star Wars. And I've written a short story and one novella about my experiences as a non-binary person, which you can find linked below. Okay, bye-bye.